Is it normal for a 25-year-old to have one droopy eyelid? My right eyelid is droopy and has been getting progressively worse. I'd say I noticed this 3 years ago, and this is what my eyes look like today. Friends and family say they don't notice it until I point it out, but it's glaringly obvious to me. Is surgery a viable option for me? When I'm tired, my eyes feel off or uneven, and it makes me want to just close the droopy one. Would surgery be able to fix that uneven feeling, and is it worth the risk?
Thank you for your question. You're 25 years old, and you've noticed your eyelid drooping, which you've shown with the photos you submitted for the past 3 years, asking if it's normal and about the feelings you have when you get tired, and of course, whether or not surgery is an option. So, this type of question is not an unusual question, but to begin with, just to give you a little bit about my background, I'm a cosmetic oculofacial plastic surgeon practicing for 20 years, which means I'm a background in eye surgery and plastic surgery of the eyes and face. So ptosis is something we deal a lot with in our practice. So to begin with, to understand the drooping of the right upper eyelid that you in the photos you submitted, I would ask you to look at previous photos. There's a condition called congenital ptosis, which is where one or both eyes are drooping because of the way the muscle that lifts the eyelid, called the levator muscle, it's like the word elevator, develops while you're during gestation. So what we want to know is, in a lot of situations, is someone may have symptoms of the drooping eyelid because the eyelid progressively gets a little bit lower, but they've had some degree of drooping eyelid throughout their lives. So that's one thing we'd want to ask. Now, if that's not the case, then we also want to rule out any unusual neurologic issues. So an examination with an ophthalmologist, neuro-ophthalmologist, neurologist is indicated to at least make sure that the eyelid drooping is not a sign or symptom of something else that may need intervention other than surgery. Traditionally or routinely, people have drooping eyelids as they get older. And when I say older, I would say over 50, 60 years old. And why is that? The muscle called the levator muscle has a tendon called the aponeurosis. And this tendon tends to get thinner and detaches. So we refer to it as involutional ptosis, a very common problem as you get older. Now that's different. That's an acquired ptosis, which is probably the most common type of ptosis there is. So being 25, you're very young for that type of situation. So again, it would be very important to first establish whether or not this is congenital ptosis, whether or not there is any other neurologic reason for the ptosis. And then once those things are ruled out, especially the systemic issues, then you can entertain surgical options. Typically, we perform this surgery under local anesthesia with light sedation, and ptosis surgery is deceptively complex. It is a very small space. It is requires the eye in the eyelid area where this very sensitive muscle has to be manipulated so that the eyelid height, shape, contour is symmetric with the other eye. There are situations where if someone presents with one drooping eyelid, when we physically lift that eyelid during an examination, the other eyelid droops. And that is a manifestation of something called Herring's Law. And that has to do with the way the brain feeds a certain amount of, we call it juice, to the eyelids, so that when you correct one, the other one will droop. And so we check for that and decide whether or not it's significant enough to actually do both eyes. Other things that we do when we do an evaluation is to do the proper evaluation of eye function in terms of when you blink and how high your eye rolls to protect the eye when you're blinking. These are part of a standard ophthalmologic oculoplastic examination. During surgery, we actually will often sit the patient up several times to evaluate what the eyelid level is relative to the effects of gravity. So we'll actually have you open and close your eyes during surgery. You never feel any pain, you're not just uncomfortable, but it helps us a lot predict the appearance of the eyes after the surgery is completed. Once this surgery is completed, we basically do the same thing we do for other cosmetic eyelid surgery procedures. We put cold compresses on the eyes and we watch you, and a week later we take stitches out. So to answer the question of a surgical option, the answer is probably, as long as we've eliminated the neurologic cause, whether it's congenital ptosis or whether it's an acquired ptosis. And I should also mention that sometimes trauma or history of trauma, whether it's motor vehicle accident or simple an accident during childhood or baseball or all kinds of things that can cause an eye to swell, the eyelid can droop because the muscle can stretch. So having an evaluation first by an ophthalmologist, possibly a neurologist, will first get you on the way of eliminating the other more systemic causes of ptosis. Once that's eliminated, then it's time for you to then identify a doctor you feel comfortable with, most likely an oculofacial or oculoplastic surgeon who almost by definition does a lot of ptosis surgery, hopefully has a cosmetic sense that resonates with you. And once you identify the right doctor, then ptosis surgery can really be very very fulfilling. It can really restore a patient's confidence and not feel so self-conscious about the asymmetry of their eyes. Within the normal population, a lot of people have a slight difference between the two eyes. It's between 1 to 2 millimeters. And that's acceptable. That's part of the reason why your family isn't acknowledging an obvious difference that they can tell. But at the same time, when you take photos, a lot of times those differences are obvious. When you get tired, those differences are obvious. So once again, begin the journey of first doing the medical evaluation, and then hopefully you'll find an oculoplastic surgeon that you like, and then move forward with your surgery. So I hope that was helpful. I wish you the best of luck, and thank you for your question.